and we'll look at the strategic difference, strategic and creative differences between distributor brands. First of all, we'll talk about the vision of the packaging from the consumer viewpoint and not from the brand's viewpoint. So let's try and see the vision of packaging by consumers, how they discover them, how they walk around in a supermarket. Then we'll identify the 16 levers that will succeed creating some packaging. And it's not so obvious, it's not so easy. And then we'll compare the response levels between all these levers, between the national brand and the retailer brand. I'll briefly introduce myself. I'm in charge of a business called Diadem, which is part of the team creative. And we develop creative aspects, technical implementation, execution, until the delivery to printers. I'm the author of two books on packaging. Certainly, some of you, some must have read one, Packaging Mode d'Emploi, which has been going on for 20 years, and it's we've published it 5 times. I've created packagings for big international brands as well as for retailers. I've been working a long time and for retailers, brands. I'm passionate with retailers, brands. So I'll tell you about a subject that passionates me. So here's the double vision of brand strategy. I work for the LSA Group packaging and for training and for Creapple, which is a Japanese brand that trains young people on packaging. This is my background. Now, concerning packaging, I'd like to put something into perspective. There's 3 main roles which are unavoidable. Protect, that's the fabric, that's the material. Then inform, that's the brand, the text, and attract, its design. Now, if we compare national brands and retailers' brands, we're even. Nobody wins. They all have understood that you need to use these 3 levers. And here it works well. And you'll see throughout this presentation that sometimes the national brand is not so good at it, at some levers. And also the retailer's brand sometimes is not so good with some levers. So let's now get into the consumer skin. Imagine yourself pushing a cart and shopping, and you'll see packaging in a different way. The first thing a consumer sees when he walks around shelves in a store, well, the first thing will appear 10 meters away, and it's color. So before, just remember, you're in a hypermarket. The average hypermarket has 45,000 different products. And the average time of purchase without the waiting online, it's 20 minutes. So in 20 minutes, the eye can only perceive 5,000 products. It's physiological. The eye can't see any more pictures, which is 260 solicitations per minute. For an oil, it will be 10 seconds, and an electric tool it will be about 2 minutes, but it depends on the category of product. But in average, only 30 products will end up in the consumer's basket. So the whole strategy, everything we'll discuss later on, will take into consideration this shopping process. So anything you do on your packaging to lower the shopping is bad. And anything that would accelerate the process is good. Now, the consumer, I said, goes very fast. He walks 4 kilometers an hour in a supermarket. This is his average speed. And at that speed, a brand representing on less than 20 centimeters of facing will not be seen. So anything I will tell you on packaging, if your packaging is 10 centimeters as you know facing, it's less than two, it won't work. So here's the context. The consumer walks around, and the first thing he'll see is color.
The color helps to identify, very often helps to identify a category. And if you sell a cola and you choose another code apart from red, you're going to slow down the purchasing act because you're going to lengthen the time of understanding what product it is. And so you shouldn't do that. These are category codes that exist for some agri-food shelving. Sometimes we'll be able to talk about non-food products as well, but mainly these category color codes are usually used for food products, and everyone's understood that if you sell oil, it's better to look for the right color rather than going to look for a new color, which could maybe give the message that it's not oil. So we need to really be close to the reality of the current packaging, because the distributors and national brands do a good job. And at the origin, obviously, originally there's a brand that created the color. But if they haven't protected this, which is often the case, it belongs to the public domain and everyone can use this category color. Some historic brands have protected, such as Kodak, with its orange type of color, but it's quite difficult to protect a color, a generic color. It's like as if you take a word from the dictionary and patent it. You're not allowed to do that. And here you can see that the brands, the big brands and the national brands, are at equal status. Nobody's a winner. On the question of color, in terms of an identification of a brand, that's the next subject. The national brands are able much more easily to have a unifying color code to correspond to their identity. But it's only in one or two categories that this exists, so it's easier to have it's much harder for a distributor, particularly in agri-food, to have a powerful transversal horizontal code. Because if he does it, he's going to use his category recognition. So if I'm a distributor, I want all my products to be blue. What do I do with Coca-Cola or oil? And that's the difficulty. It's difficult for the distributors, except for non-food products, where yes, the category codes are not don't really exist. It's easy for the distributor to have a color, a horizontal, across-the-board color identity. Here you can see the national brands that are the winners and the specialists, generic agri-food. They have the agri-food have not yet found the solution, sorry. The color helps you to identify a brand and to clarify the segmentation of the offer. And here also, when the color codes for segmentation exists, everyone knows more or less what they know the color of the carton of milk that they buy. For most of us, it's usually blue, which means that semi-skimmed milk. And the same applies to other categories of milk. Whole milk is red and completely skimmed milk is green. And that is the case in some categories. For example, coffee here, it's clear that for everybody, in France, I'd like to be, because in the United States, it's different. In France, blue is decaf. If you're a distributor and you sell decaffeinated coffee, there's no point in reinventing the consumer's logic. You need to facilitate the act of purchase. Sometimes the category codes get mixed up with the brand. For example, Abbe beers. We've got several distributors that have launched Abbe beer. Looks similar to Lef. Is it a category code, or is it a color that clarifies the purchasing at we? If I'm looking for an Abbe beer, I know that I'll find it mainly in a yellow type of color, and that simplifies the consumer's purchase. There are very few categories, or the color codes are understood by the consumers. There are just a few, but not many at all. Here, after that, everyone suffers from the same problem, which is to clarify and segment the offer For example, we've got the example in the same category. We've got a distributor who's differentiated by who differentiates his products through green, blue, and orange. And what does he say? Okay, be careful. It's not the same product. There are three different products. And the national brand says the same thing, alerting the consumer it's not the same products. But there's no significant color code to make it possible to say that it's with cheese or with ham or whatever. There's no understood consumer logic. So be careful with packaging colors. It's very complicated, and we try and make colors say lots of different things, and that's not my subject, but it's a very complicated subject, so be careful. There's all the logics come apart when you try and think about it. For example, Findus, that use red for frozen products, whereas the color that most people would think about would be blue or white, but not red. But when you ask Findus why red, they say, it's simple. I don't want to sell the idea of cold. I want to sell the idea of red, meaning they're going to cook the product. So it's very complicated. But continuing to move on, the consumer is always like 10 meters away. He's starting to get close. He sees the segmentation, and then he comes within 4 meters of the product. And for the first time, he's going to see the shape of the packaging. The shape of the packaging says several things. For example, the category. When you've got a bottle of water green like this, the color says that it's sparkling water, and the shape, which is smooth, opposite a blue striped bottle, which says that it's still water, and confirms by the shape that it's still water. So the consumer instinctively will decode these logical messages and recognize the categories. You have some brands who are stronger, more powerful, because they've managed to impose shapes that are characteristic and give them an incredible identity. There's two examples here, Orangina, with this bottle. You can almost touch the bottle. You recognize it straight away through its characteristic shape. And then the duck WC product, which it's everything that's done in packaging has to be done to provide a service to the consumer. You can't deceive the consumer. They've had this good idea from a functional point of view. Gives a kind of affectionate aspect to this product, making it look like a duck, which strengthens its relationship with us. And then on the other side, you've got distributors brands, which are not really very creative in terms of shape. There's several problems. One is the volume problem. When you create a bottle of Badoit water for world markets, you've got big quantities. When you're a distributor locally, the quantities don't always make it possible to take into consideration the same things. But in any case, if I was a distributor, I'd be careful not to move too away from the category codes when they're really well known, such as still water and sparkling water. Here you can see more of a trend where the distributors follow the brands, and that's why we think that the brands are better than the distributors, more creative. This leads us to another packaging function, which we call the identity, the identity alert. Through the shape of the packaging, you understand you've got two bars of chocolate, and then looking at the dominant color of the two packages, and you can see that the distributor is inspired by the leader's color to direct the consumer to understanding what category it is. Following on, once you've worked on the shape, you can go a bit further and have shapes that are distinctive, original, able to be memorized. That's very important. But it's everything that we say here, the more people memorize, that it's easy to memorize, the more people will buy the product. A little grandmother, she goes into the pharmacy. So I want them to buy the tablets with the little red spots. She remembers the packaging, and it's exactly the same in distribution. Here, the brands have imposed category colors and have invented packaging codes. and the distributor brands have followed them. They haven't yet invested into this register sufficiently, and the distributor's brand is not the winner in this register. You've got one distributor's brand, which has done wonderful work recently on lamps. We've got the Auchan national brands. It's reinvented the way that the lamps are, bulbs are wrapped up, with one of the ends very easily visible and original packaging. And I think it's been rewarded, actually. And it's possible for a distributor brand, it's possible for them to innovate and to bring solutions on the services. The fact that you see some of the bulb and strengthen the idea that you're serving the customer. Now, this is a graphics chart of the packaging, and this will create a transverse or a horizontal identity across the board, powerful or not powerful, for the brands. For example, you have a distributor who has a horizontal, very powerful horizontal identity, and it's possible to have a graphic identity that's recognizable in all categories, in the same way that most big brands have already answered positively to this challenge. It's very hard for distributors to go as far as that. There's very few examples today. Maybe Marks and Spencer's, Monoprix in France, is the leader in this. There's one defect which Monoprix has not yet sorted out, to have one horizontal color code that says Monoprix. At the moment, Monoprix is a graphics chart, a way of expressing themselves in terms of typology and rights, but not color codes. So Monoprix still needs to work on color code, but he's a long way ahead of the others in terms of the identification provided by the graphics chart. And where things are not so good, it's just when they get to 1 meter of the product, and only at 1 meter will he see which brand it is. He recognizes and memorizes them. You feel them, but you don't read them, which has helped a lot of people to play on that. For example, with the same typo, you see Canal Plus instead of Coca-Cola. At 1 meter, the brand will play a part, which is why a lot of consumers bought cola, thinking that they bought Coca-Cola, because they haven't read the brand name, because there's a graphics confusion. And this is something that this confirms that purchasing is very spontaneous. So a logo, which is really efficient, is a shape, because the shape isolates the logo graphically. It's important to have a logo that you can separate from the other parts of the packaging. And then a color, a dominant color. One typography and a symbol. There's two types of brands. You can see on the bottom, you can see that distributors don't really assume their identity. You can just see Auchan really small on the bottom on the right. So they want to communicate. It becomes a kind of brandless product, and they're playing on the fact that, but you're ignoring the fact that the consumer needs to read the brand name, and it's like a guarantee for the quality. So it's important. On the opposite, you've got the brands on the top right-hand corner, which is the house brands. And you can see it's a bit of a problem because it's like it's deceiving the consumer. I don't know whether it's on purpose or not. Pâturage is a fine logo. It's really within the category, but it's taken up all the leader brands' codes. Is it really a brand? No, because the brand needs its own identity, because it's through its own identity that it's going to transmit its values and its commitments. And this is there's probably a lot of progress needs to be made for in-house brands. Packaging codes, identifying the codes. This is complicated. When you work on a category or a product, when you create packaging, you need to understand the category. And that's something difficult. for most brands, and a lot less difficult for the distributors, because distributors manage categories, and they understand when they sell eggs, they know how to sell eggs. When you've got some industrial producers that are going to try and mark themselves out from the competition by selling eggs differently, it's very creative, but it's no longer eggs. For the consumer, it's something new, okay, it's pretty, but it's not eggs anymore. So after a while, I'm going to understand that it's eggs, but it's too much time. I take too much time because the purchase will be done quickly. I'm looking for eggs. I'm not looking for, I don't want to be bothered. And so I don't understand that I'm buying eggs here. So I zap and I go to eggs, something that looks like eggs because I want eggs. So this innovation, which is what brands are supposed to do, is not as easy to do as all that, which means that a lot of brands make mistakes and don't understand the category codes, and they want to try and reinvent them. It's good to invent codes, but you need the means to do that. You need to be the only one on the market. You should be the leader. It's complicated. If you sell eggs, be careful. Don't go too far. Clearly, the idea you'll see this in the text later on. Later, the consumer, when he's in front of the shelf, he'll pick up the product and have what we call a tactile relationship with the product. He's going to touch it. And that's very important in packaging, and it'll help us to trigger the feeling that you become the owner. I'm touching this product, it's continuing to speak me, I feel something. And these emotions will make me want to not put it back again, but to keep it in my hand. And the first product that you're going to pick up will be the reference product for validating the, because you're going to walk up and down in the shelves, wondering whether you're going to buy this one or another one. And in more than 80% of cases, you buy the first one you pick up. And so you can see there's some of this, for example, to please the feeling when you touch it, you've got this crackly paper and the bottle with the surface. And as soon as you touch it, you know that it's, or even if you've got your eyes closed, you know it's Orangina. You've got the bars, the chocolates with the soft or shiny touch feeling on the same package. These are things that make you want to buy the product. For example, cans of drink, metal cans with dents in them, and that will give you a certain feeling when you hold them. And you can see that the brand name has not really worked on the touch aspect. It's as though there's only one sense, the sense of smell, the sense of touching, it's very important for the consumer, and the distributor doesn't work enough on these subjects. Distributors working a bit on smell, but rather in sales outlets than with packaging. So once again, national brands are clear leaders in this register. We'll do a little summary at the end. If you're a distributor, what are the levers that you can use if you're an industrial producer? What are the levers that you can use? We'll have a little summary at the end. Once you've bought the product, something very important will happen, and that's the touching relationship with the packaging. You've got brands that are able to generate purchases just because of your movements. We have one brilliant example, which is Tessa with the new Dosa, and all the daddy sugar range, pomput packaging, which is apple puree. And so I'm not just eating stewed apple, I'm compressing it in my mouth, etc. There's a whole touching relationship, a gestural relationship that you don't find on the brand names, the house brands. And why not invent something? Because initially, the things that you could invent are things that serve the customer, that will help the customer in their relationship with the product. So why should just the brand names be able to do this? I think that really the you could think more about this. We need to understand that gestures, it seems harmless, but if I put the best champagne in the world in a wine bottle, it doesn't work, and the opposite doesn't work either. There's a way of opening the bottle, the way of handling it, and that will completely change the vision and perception of the product. The following slide is maybe the only slide, so I advise the distributors to memorize. It's the most important, and it's the key of packaging. It's the motor, and those that have understood it, they know how to do packaging. It's the typesetting is very important, because you can send a whole lot of messages through the design of the letters. Here you've got powder, detergent powder, telling a story with different types of typo, different types, and then you've got the distributor's brand name next to it, which is probably just as good. I've got no problem with the quality, the distributor's quality. I buy it myself, but here the message is not clear. I think that this powder is probably less effective than the one next to it. Probably. Why? Because the typographic message here has not been worked on properly. So the national brands are real winners here. I could have taken loads of examples. I've really picked up pictures, kind of like a caricature. And I'm sorry for those that are here if they see their packaging on my screen, but it's just really to help us understand. Okay, that's typography. If I insist on typography, it's help you understand the secret of packaging is that you never have the same typography on each line. Here, you've got one typo here, one here, another one here, another one here, and there's an arrow. This is another type of typography. In fact, each level of information needs a different typography. It's the opposite of what you do when you publish. If you publish a brochure, you're going to take one font and one typography, and you're going to have the same in bold and light and italics. But in packaging, you don't do that. I can see straight away whether it's a specialist or not who's designed the pack through the typographical choices. And you can see what happens you could see one that tells a story and the other that just communicates the product. You can see the difference here. Afterwards, we said that the winners in this category were the national brands, but on the following slide, it's the national distributors are the big winners. It seems that the industrial producers have lost their good sense. But here, the distributor brands have been able to translate in very simple texts to explain complicated products, and they know how to clearly identify in words that the consumer understands, which is not necessarily the case of national brand names. You can see a little company is very dynamic, but in terms of their packaging, there's too much information on their packaging. You've got Ideal Soup, Velvet Cream. It's true. It's fresh. It's ready. 100% natural. You've probably lost the consumer there. So that's just a very simple example, but you can see the difference. So the industrial producers tend to invent words because they want to seem more intelligent than the consumer, which doesn't help at all. But the best idea is to make the consumer intelligent rather than making the brand intelligent. When for certain categories, you've got texts that are not even understandable, it's not a good thing for purchasing. Remember that just a few seconds, in a few seconds I can buy this product, but I don't know whether I have a few more seconds to buy the more complicated one. Another thing where the distributor brands are really progressing but still behind it's images, photos, or illustrations. Packaging is a little tiny surface of several square centimeters, and in the shelves, people walk by really quickly. And the image, the picture, needs to strike you. It needs to be even a bit forced, a bit caricatured, to help the consumer to understand straight away what it is. So the industrial producers forced the contrasts, because it's a good thing, because there's a graphics chain behind. You've got packaging, which is going to be printed. It's not necessarily the best. The printing doesn't really bring out the contrast necessarily, so you increase the you exaggerate the contrast. And then here, you have pictures that are probably nice pictures originally, but the final result doesn't create the same sensation. But they are making progress, because the distributor brands are starting to understand that they need to invest in this, and particularly in one of the aspects, which is Photoshop, retouching photos, because there's no picture that doesn't need to be retouched or modified, adjusted. It's not to deceive the customer, but you need to really improve the pictures. Here you can see it's been cleaned to make the carrots look better. Here we've corrected the shine. You can see the difference between the. We've changed the color slightly. We're not lying. There's no point in lying, because when you open the box, what you see inside has to match what you've seen on the photo. But it's more appetizing and more pleasant to buy. This is for improving photos, enhancing photos. Everybody needs to work on this. And then, once again, the distributor brands win again. And this is the windows. The industrial producers tend to hide the product, and the distributors seem to want to show the product. And it's very easy to find distributor brands with windows. The consumers love, 80% of consumers want to see the product.
And, retailers, brands do buy the product because of its look. Also, the industrial doesn't necessarily have the nice-looking product. That's why the industrial will prefer the picture instead of the window, whereas the retailer prefers the window. Also, what really matters, when let's say a consumer has two products in his hands, a retailer's product and an industrial's product, the question is, why should I buy one thing instead of the other one? And this is what we'll call the benefit product, the plus product. Here, the consumer must understand by one sentence, by one word, why he should take this one instead of that one. Here you have distributors who, for instance, explained that it's made in the store. Here it's fresh milk from the farm. Here I understand well why I should buy this product instead of another one. And you know, consumers spend time trying to understand why I'm to buy this product. And here there's also national brands that do better, because they've understood distributors, retailers, brand could get back to this point if they ask themselves the question, that's all. Now, visual cumulation. This is what happens when a packaging reproduced by the multiplicity of its images. When we create a packaging for a big brand, we think of the mass effect. So we don't just think of the isolated image, but with regards to its mass. I've worked for a lot of retailers. I've done a lot of packs for retailers, and I've never stressed that point. Which means that it's not their concern. Why? Because retailers think that they control their shelves, so they'll do whatever they please. But I'm talking about accumulation effect, not a mass effect. So, of course, the visual linear effect reinforces the identity and participates in the message. So I think there's room for improvement. And I'd advise distributors who are in the rule to always look at the objects created as a mass. And I tell you, it will not be the same. Now, here's a topic on which nobody wins, and it's online. Today, you have two examples here of packaging that were made for stores. And here, the same packagings revisited to be sold on online sites, online webs. Why? Because packaging is a few square centimeters. But when we sell online, we're talking about a few square millimeters, and the surface is quite small, and packaging should keep on working so that we can click on the basket. So we've simplified implications. A lot of texts are leaving. We revisited the sizes, the proportions, so that it works online. And because we have all the informations that have disappeared from the facing, and they're on the side. If you're interested and you do this kind of work legally, you should be careful, because you can't do things on the facing when they're on the shelf. They have to respond to the reality on the store, because this is the reality that the consumer will get. This is what he's clicked on. This is what he'll get in his basket. So careful not to traffic the look of packages or anything. And then there's a whole dynamic being implemented on connected packagings. It's not the topic of my presentation, but there would be a lot to say. A lot will happen. Right now, nobody has done anything significant yet. And I think that the MDDs that I've met lately, I've seen none that has worked on it. But it may be in confidential dossiers, but I have no information on that. So this is the vision of what will enable you to make a packaging. Now, let's look at a few brands that I wanted you to see. Here's an example of what happens in reality. Oreo is an international brand, and this is the work of retailers on this category. So are we on this category, or is it a brand? Are we fighting a brand or a category? First question we may ask ourselves. If it's a category, it's been invented by Oreo, and all the retailers have reproduced the Oreo product. So we start from the idea that it's a category, and then they went to look for inspiration in the Oreo packaging. So when the inspiration is good, let's say that it's a bit borderline concerning ethics and copy, but when it's not good, we're far from the category. So the problem is not easy. It's not. When you're a retailer, you must wonder whether you should go to the three, the lower three or ones, or the two of the tops are interesting because they revisit the color code, but it's a bit borderline. We've reproduced all the effects. It's quite a copy. So I think retailers should work on this topic and try and reinvent things and bring answers. Maybe some things. There's some things could be said about it, but we haven't asked ourselves the question. Same thing for kids' toys. Again, a distributor's brand, a retailer's brand, which follows the national brand. It's not even better. It's an answer. I'd like you to all know that being follower is not a defect. I haven't said it. There's three possible strategies in marketing. Can be a leader, you've invented codes, but as challenger strategy where you surf, you bring something more, and the follower well, makes you retake the existing codes and you use them for yourself. So it's not forbidden. Then we'll see there's different ways to do it. So here it's a retailer's brand that could make us dream in France, Marks and Spencer's. There's nothing like it. Monoprix does it a bit, but it's still not a premium brand as Marks and Spencer. Having a Marks and Spencer's product is quite prestigious. It's not the case for Monoprix. It will become so, but for the rest of distributors, it's not the case. So it's surprising because we wonder when the French style will come in MDD. Marks and Spencer has imposed its style. Why no MDD has invented its own style and identity? We may wonder, especially for food retailers. We're in a country where, gastronomy, food is a reference. So I don't think it will take too long before we see that. Now, the unpleasant topic, copies, it's finished. I haven't met one single distributor that has asked me to copy anything. That's not true. You know, the Oreo phenomenon, it feels like it's been copied. It's not what they wanted. I mean, sometimes we don't understand really what we do, and in the end, the result is not good. The real copy, as we known it in retailers some years ago, doesn't exist anymore because nobody is interested and nobody wins because the brand is copy and it's hard to deal with. The relationship with the client is not good, and it's not very good for retailers. So it doesn't exist anymore. But copy is not, it's not forbidden to copy. You may find it strange. You may copy, but you at this level. Here's an example of a Breton brand that copied Coke. For the ones who know Brittany, you know that it's a real buzz. Everybody wants this bottle in all Brittany stores. It's possible to copy, but you should do it with creativity. We should invent something, and this is what happened with this brand, and make it move ahead. Then there's another. Aspect where national brands lose, and it's funny because retailers win, and it's humor. Amazing, isn't it? Do retailers have humor? Well, it's not so obvious if you see what you see. There's fashionable biscuits in Intermarché and cookies, and I would dream of working on this type of products. All my eggs of happiness this year make April sardines, April's first sardines. And on the other hand, you have the national brand that have never done anything. So you have Caramba, and it's not, you know, that there's a funny story inside, and it's not quite humor. Then you have categories like innocent, but it's not quite humor. It's more emotion. It's borderline. I've also looked at Michel and Augustin. It's a bit of an emotion, and you tell the story differently, but this is not quite humor. And this is pure humor. You have fruit juice from Intermarché. Their the label changes depending on the hour when the bottle is filled. So it's funny, isn't it? And it's possible to do it. And this was invented by retailers, and brands don't dare doing it. So, still a few more elements. Here's a brand that did organic products. It's an MDD that did organic products. This is something that doesn't work for me because we've used packaging codes for a classical mass consumption with colors, with white paper, with a story that I don't believe in, because you get rid of the little leaves on the eye of the name bio, which means organic in French. And that's it. You've lost it. So if you want to start a segment, then do it well. Maybe with a Kraftwerk packaging, it would have worked well. Brown paper packaging, it would have worked fine, but here doesn't work much. You'll see two retailers that have a great image strategy, and they work really well. They're from abroad. Eco did a great packaging strategy with a very simple identity, but in spite of all, quite premium, with a quality story on ingredient typology. You know, letters are great. And there's another retailer who communicates with a great graphic chart. Sorry for the quality of the picture. You understand perfectly that this is a low price product, a first price product, but with a percentage logo, you understand that you'll do a good deal. And it's an identity which is easy to remember. So I'll remember it. I understand the promise. This is a retailer's brand that tells me a good story, and it corresponds to this category of products of buying, of shopping act, which are a first price act. All retailers have worked on this, and obviously these are approaches with minimal packagings, not to let you think that this is expensive. And I like it when I see these pictures or the one before, I see it's clear. I know that I'm going to buy a cheap product. Packaging does its work, and we don't want anything more from it. And of course, you'll find a few elements that we saw together. Then I'd like to introduce the packaging evolution, I think, is about. You have to be very careful. You understood that at the beginning of the presentation, the purchase or the shopping act goes really fast. If you change the packaging throughout the year, you can go from that to that, because the purchase act goes fast, and so you'll lose consumers on the way. And it's happened to all of us to not find products that we had bought previously, first of all, because it was hard to remember them, and secondly, because sometimes, the changes in packaging get us lost, and then you lose consumers on the way. So now let's conclude. And before concluding, I'll tell you something. Packaging is like a clock. Open your clock and look at the mechanism in the back, and you'll see a lots of small parts, and you'll get one little spare part. You won't see which one I took out, but you'll see that your watch doesn't work anymore. Same thing with the packaging. It's everything we've seen gets together and works together. And if it all doesn't work together right, then it won't work anymore. So this is why we've seen retailers' packagings that seem like they didn't work when they were placed next to the brand, or sometimes the big brand packagings didn't work well because they didn't get that clock aspect of the thing. Now, to conclude, I have some things that I'd like to tell you as a conclusion. First of all, retailers should stop doing matrix charts that explain cooked meals the same way as toilet paper. It doesn't work. So you have to change the graphic chart of the retailers to take into account the fact that the categories change, to see whether a product should get into the same category. You know, one product on toilet paper is in the same category as the cooked, as a prepared meal. No. So we must stick to the product. Now, conclusion. We've seen, in spite of all, that there are too many copies. I've put a synthesis. I've said a synthesis because it's not quite a copy, but a nice synthesis was made of brands, and it can look like a copy. So retailers should not do that. Some are not doing it anymore, but still they should work on it. There's two retailers' products here that don't communicate on anything. There's no values, there's no commitment. there's nothing to sell. And also the retailer's brand, the U product, there's a good size logo. The store has shown the product well. And this is a brand strategy. So here are a few, these are a few advices to retailers. Now, for both retailers and national brands. First thing I'll tell you, re-legitimate your brands with concerns to MDD. Why do you want a consumer to buy a brand cotton and not a retailer's brand cotton? Why should you buy a regular product with a brand? So you need to give reasons to buy your product instead of the retailer's brand. Defend your expertise, your know-hows. The brand has a know-how that the retailer doesn't, because the brand only works on one product, on one category, so it's much easier, and it's a strength. So less superlatives, less sublimated. You know, brands do too much. So just tell the truth on your product. And the last advice, stop getting your pictures stolen. Patent your concepts, and you'll see, patent your designs. You'll see that to patent a design, the design has to be really powerful, so it will help you go above. So from the retailer's side, a few advice. We should re-dynamize the brand status. The retailer's brand is an alternative to the brand. So, you know, have the price can be minus 20, minus 30, but it's a bit of a pity. You know, everything is summarized to the price, and retailer's brand can be committed. We've seen Intermarché with very nice commitments. Can't remember what the slogan won, but it was the retailer who is also a producer. So it's a nice story. And you give content to your brand. Of course, more truth. A lot of people are analyzing a retailer's brand. There's ethics. There's a lot of things. And it doesn't always show in the packaging. So I think retailers should explain more about their work and also a clean identity. You need an identity, considering, of course, the category codes that are hard to manage. Here's an example of Leroy Merlin that made a chart on products, which is quite strong, a national brand that has re-legitimated itself. It was dead, and it succeeded to meet all these points to re-dynamize itself. So as a synthesis, two more slides. The 16 levers I mentioned in the introduction, here they are. Primary function, break even. Category colors, break even. Segmentation, break even. Everybody's understood what's the challenge. When there's existing codes, we follow this inspiration. When there aren't, we create them or we add some. Now, brand shapes and materials, the national brands win. Also, the alert on packaging, national brands are better. Now, graphic charts, national and international brands are always very strong. But retailers are progressing a lot. We've seen Monoprix work on it, and they're very aware of it, as we've seen. The logo, the national brands are better. They win. Now, codes per market. Now, these are retailers who are better at analyzing categories. Tactile and movements, retailers are not even aware of it, so the brands are win over by KO. Text and facing retailers, but letters, this is brands. And pictures, text-facing retailers win. Windows also retailers win. Pictures, and these are the national brands, but not too much better. Now, but product benefits, brands, linear accumulated effect brands and packaging online brands. So mega synthesis, you're a retailer. Here's what you should brief your partners on and your agencies. The alert function must be much stronger. The size, the shape, materials. You must invent tactile solutions, movements and typos. Everything has to be reviewed. So retailers have to really understand what's at stake. Also, product benefits. You know, it's not enough to say I'm 20% less expensive than the brand. But why is it better? Why is my product better? What is it more? Now, the linear mass effect, it's not too complicated, but you have to take into consideration the online pack. Same thing for both. And then the national brand must understand market codes better. It's to stop reinventing all the time, especially when they don't have the means. Text facing, we don't understand the product. What is it? What is the market code? We don't see anything transparent, whereas we could have seen it on a new product. We don't understand the juice. This is a national brand which has no clue. And here's a retailer that doesn't meet all these points. So this is the synthesis of what should be done. There's a bit more work in retailers' brand than in national brand, but I mean everybody should work on that. And another thing, careful with the graphic chain. National brands and retailers are very careful with this, but actually, a product comes and has to the store, and it doesn't look at all like it looked at the beginning in the project. So there's a graphic, and the products that will be printed in offset, exo, helio in different plants. So the consequences of the non-control of these graphic stages are really big. Especially, you know, send people for the first print to control the first print in every plant where they print. And that's it. I'd like to thank you for your attention. If you have a question, I'm available for you. And if some of you want me to make this presentation in your plant, you know, of course, or in your business, of course, I'd be pleased to do so. We can speak afterward. Questions? Everything's clear. Is that all right? Nobody's crossed with me? No? Okay, well, thank you very much. See you soon.